Thanks for joining us for today's message. We are currently in a 10-week campaign entitled Daring Faith, where we are dedicated to growing everybody's faith, both individually and corporately as a body of Christ. And we'd love to connect with you and learn if this ministry has been a blessing to you. We'd love to hear from you. You can send us an email to info@hftwchurch.org. If you'd like to be a blessing to this ministry, you may do so by visiting hftwchurch.org/give. We pray that this message would be a blessing to you and that it would inspire you to live in the daring faith that Jesus has for you.
Well, my name is Jason Walker, and I'm one of the pastors, and I'm just so honored to be here sharing with you. Most of you probably heard that our senior pastor, Dale, he had a fall a few weeks ago. He fell off of a mountain, and so he really injured his lower left leg. He had surgery, and thank God he just got out of the hospital. He's home, and so that's a victory. He was telling us that this is the first Easter probably in his entire life that he hasn't been at church. And so he's really just missing everyone. He's missing being in here. And just know that he loves you all very much, and just so appreciate your prayers. And I'm just so honored to be here, and I'm going to just continue our series, Daring Faith. We began a few weeks ago, and just really excited about what God's going to do in our church over the next 6 weeks. God is wanting to increase our faith so that he can do miracles that we never thought were possible. We need new faith for the new miracles God wants to do. And God is going to increase our faith over the next 6 weeks. And I just encourage you all, please connect. Please connect with our church during this time. Please join a small group, because you're going to witness miracles. God is going to change your life. He's going to do things you never thought he could. And as I was thinking about daring faith, did any of you ever play Truth or Dare as a kid? You remember that game? And I was just thinking about daring and, you know, trying something new that maybe you never tried or that seemed scary. I was remembering when I was 8 years old, the harvest party was coming up. For those of you that are come to our church, you know the harvest party is our biggest outreach of the year. And so we were doing this 30 years ago. I was 8 years old, and as we're preparing for the harvest party, my older cousin said, "Hey, let's perform a rap for the whole church that comes." And so it was 1985 or 86, and so, you know, if you remember that year, the Chicago Bears were the team to beat, and they had a rap, "We Are the Bears," and so we kind of did a spoof on that rap, and we put Jesus in the rap. And now, I mean, I know when you look at me, you see rapper written right across my face, right? I'm just this little white kid. and so here we go, harvest party. It's showtime. This is the first time I've ever performed in any capacity. I mean, I did as, you know, a kid's choir or something, but this is like I have a solo act. And so the guy before us, he also has a rap. And so he goes up there, he's got dry ice, and it's just like smoke, and his rap is cool, and it's got a beat to it, and I mean, it's legit, you know? And then we get up there, and we got this lame little dance, and, you know, so me being the good manager that I am, before we start, I'm inspecting the microphone. All right, let's make sure this mic is working. And so I turn it, I think I turn it on, but I turn it off. And so I didn't, you know, I wasn't a good troubleshooter at 8 years old. So when it comes to my turn, I'm doing my rap and no one can hear me. And it was just a complete bomb. It was my daring faith that fell flat on its face. Now, I could have been the next Vanilla Ice. That's good. I need Isaiah to come up here and help me break it down. Alas, it didn't happen, and I turned into an accountant instead. But I'm a legend at the accounting firm, I'll tell you. Just kidding. Now I'm a pastor. I was an accountant, but now. That was my daring faith. But God wants us to dare, to try something new, to step out, to believe that he can do something great in our life. And today, I want to talk to you about the biggest dare of all, the dare to believe that Jesus is who he said he is, and that he is the Son of God, and that he rose again, and he now lives in heaven. I just want to read a little bit from the resurrection story. This is found in Matthew 28, if we could show those verses up here. It says, "Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the women. 'Don't be afraid,' he said. 'I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He isn't here. He's risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I've told you.' The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy, and they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. And as they went, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they ran to him, grasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there.'" We're here celebrating Easter. All of you are here because you've heard, most likely you've heard the news. Jesus died and rose again. If that didn't happen, there would be no purpose for us to be here. But because that happened, we are here. And that's what we're going to discuss today. And so the three things I want to share with you today is, first, the resurrection is historical. Second, the resurrection is foundational. And third, the resurrection is personal. First, the resurrection is historical. The resurrection, as Christians, we view the resurrection as an actual event that took place. It's not a fairy tale. It's not a legend. For the Christian, it is the defining moment in our history, in our faith. You know, what one of the things that sets Christianity apart from all other religions is that our God, Jesus, he died, but he didn't stay dead. He came back to life. And it wasn't just like he was in the hospital and he got resuscitated and then he died later. No, he died, he rose, and he's still alive. All other religions, none of them make that claim. All of their gods are dead. Buddha, Muhammad, the prophet, they're all dead. They all died of natural causes or poison or whatever it was. But our Jesus, he didn't die of natural causes. What's so amazing about our God is he was seated at the right hand of the Father, and he chose to come to earth. The reason he chose to come to earth was because our sin separated us from God. God created us to live in perfect harmony and unity with him, and then we chose to sin, and our sin separated us from God. And the only way to rebuild that bridge between us and God was for someone to pay a price, for someone to rebuild the bridge. And the price could only be paid with a perfect sacrifice, with perfect blood, and that was the Son of God. And so Jesus came to earth. He laid down his life. He wasn't killed by natural causes. He gave his life willingly. And the beauty of the cross and the beauty of Jesus is that he's not dead. He came out of that tomb. He's alive. He ascended to heaven, and he is now seated on the throne. And he sent his Holy Spirit, and now his presence is everywhere that we invite him. And he's here now. The Holy Spirit is here right now. I was reading about Carl Sagan. Maybe some of you remember him. He was a scientist and astronomer in the 80s and 90s. He had a show on PBS, Cosmos, and he was a very well-known guy, but as smart as he was, he said, I see no proof of God or the afterlife. And he was asking another guy, how can you justify the leap of faith that you're talking about in spite of a total lack of evidence? Even all the creation and all the beauty, if that wasn't evidence enough, somehow he missed the historical account that is laid out before us in the Bible. And so I just want to share a few of these things with you. First of all, this passage that I just read, if you were going to write an account of someone that had just risen from the dead, and you were going to try to convince them that it was true, you would never do it the way the gospel writers did it. First of all, because the first witnesses were women. And in that culture and in that society, a woman was considered a second-class citizen. Women's testimony was inadmissible at court. They had no standing. Their word meant nothing in that culture. And yet all the gospel writers say that the first witnesses to Christ's resurrection were women. Now, why would they write that? If they were trying to win an argument, they wouldn't write that unless it was true. Look at this verse in 1 Corinthians 15. I put it in your notes. He was seen by Peter, he meaning Jesus, was seen by Peter and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. This is amazing. Paul is writing this letter to the church of Corinth. He's writing it within 30 years of the resurrection. So this isn't like a legend. Like, Paul isn't writing this 300 years later where he can write whatever he wants and nobody can go back and prove or disprove what he's saying. He's writing this within 30 years of Jesus rising from the dead. And so he goes on, he says in this passage, Jesus appeared, and he appeared to 500 people at one time. Now that is a very strong case of evidence. That would stand up in any court of law, to have 500 witnesses at one time. Sometimes people hold the Bible to a standard that they would never hold other historical documents to. They say, well, there's not other documents that refer to Jesus' resurrection. But the opposite of that is true too. You don't see documents saying that it's not true. The eyewitnesses were there. When this was written, the people were alive. You could go to them and ask them, did you really see Jesus? What was it like? What did he do? This was a resurrected Jesus who had a new body. This wasn't a ghost or a zombie or a spirit. This was a Jesus resurrected with a new body. He was eating with them. He was talking to them. He was ministering to them. He had a resurrected body. What would you do if a person that was dead came back to life? This person was Jesus, who when he was alive, he said, I'm the Son of God. And he proved it over and over by the miracles he did and his teaching. And then the icing on the cake, he dies and then he comes back to life. Here's the people faced with this person that has just come out of the grave. This is not in their worldview. The Jewish people were expecting a Messiah to come, but they were expecting him to come and establish his kingdom in Jerusalem and to overthrow the Roman government and to basically rule the world and just reign with the Messiah here on earth. They were not expecting a Messiah that would come, die on a cross, raise again, and ascend into heaven. This was not in their frame of reference. So it's not like, oh yeah, we knew that was going to happen, so we can believe it. No, this was a shock to them. And here they are, 500 witnesses. Some people will say, well, maybe it was just a hallucination. There's no such thing as a group hallucination. You know, even if somebody was smoking pot in there, it's not going to spread to 500 people. This was a fact. This was Jesus standing in front of them. Some people will say, well, maybe it was a hoax. Maybe someone just told them Jesus was alive and they believed it. But if that were true, you would really have to question why they would be willing to die for a hoax. The first believers were persecuted like no other. And so if someone came up to you and said, recant your faith or I'm going to feed you to a lion, or recant your faith or I'm going to burn you alive, you better be sure about what you believe, right? If they were believing a hoax, do you think they would be willing to do that? Because that's what happened to many of them. They were nailed to a cross, all kinds of ways that they were martyred, they were killed, because they believed that Jesus was the Son of God and that he rose again. Amen. Through the power of the resurrection, Jesus is offering us a new life in every way, not just so that we can have eternal life, but even we can have new life here on earth, that heaven can come into this broken world and can change us from the inside out. Many of us, most of us, accept the historical fact that Jesus rose from the dead, that he died and rose from the dead, but we've never truly worked out the implications of that in our life. What does that mean if Jesus really rose from the dead? Wow, that must mean that what he wrote in the Bible is true. And that must mean that what the Bible says about God is true, and what the Bible says about me is true, and that God must have created me for a purpose and a destiny. I might want to figure out what this is all about. This is life-altering. Some of you, maybe you don't believe in the historical evidence. You say that's just fantasy. And if you're there, I would just challenge you to really dig and research it yourself, because if that's your stance, then you, to be intellectually honest, you would need to come up with a plausible explanation for how the Christian church started 2,000 years ago and how people were so convinced that they saw Jesus that they changed their entire life. Their lives were changed, and that the gospel message has spread across the whole world, and that billions of people's lives have been changed forever. You would have to come up with some plausible explanation if you don't believe in the historical fact that Jesus died and rose again. We're talking about faith. What is faith? Faith is not superstition. Faith is not believing in a fairy tale. I'm not standing up here asking you to believe me just because I'm a pastor and you can trust me. Faith is using your mind. It's using your logic. It's using your brain. God gave it to you for a reason. He wants you to dig. He wants you to study. He wants you to discover the truth for yourself. True faith is grounded in the belief of the historical fact that Jesus was risen from the dead. Just as sure as I believe that the War of Independence happened 200 plus years ago, I'm sure that Jesus died and rose. I'm sure that the War of Independence happened. Why? Because I'm here in America. You're here in America. We get to experience the freedom from the people who fought before us in many wars. And we know that we're free in this country because of what happened. And it's the same thing with the resurrection. I know because of the historical evidence, and I know because my life has been changed. And many of your lives have been changed. You've never been the same because the reality of the resurrected Jesus is now living inside of you, and you're a different person. The resurrection is historical. Second, the resurrection is foundational. It's the bedrock of our faith. I'm going to read this story in Acts chapter 9, if we could show that up there. Meanwhile, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. So he went to the high priest. He requested letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any followers of the way were the Christians. Any of them that he found there, he wanted to bring them, both men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains. As he was approaching Damascus on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. And the voice replied, "I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men with Saul stood speechless, for they heard the sound of someone's voice, but saw no one. Saul picked himself up off the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus. He remained there blind for 3 days and did not eat or drink. Now Saul was a very powerful man. Many of you would know that Saul eventually became Paul. But Saul was a scholarly man. He was very smart. He knew the scripture. He knew the Bible. And then his world was getting turned upside down, because here's all these people that are going around saying, "The Messiah has come. Jesus, he is the Messiah. He died on the cross and now he's risen. He's calling us to repent of our sins, and he'll forgive us, and he'll change our lives, and he'll fill us with the Holy Spirit." And so Saul is just, he's angry, he's raging. He's killing people. He's killing Christians. He's persecuting them. He wants to put him in prison. He has a personal mission to stamp out Christians, to destroy the Christian faith. And he's on his way to get some more, to round some more Christians up, when all of a sudden he has an encounter with the resurrected Jesus. Jesus had already ascended to heaven, but now he came back down for a special visit just with Saul. And so the first thing I want you to see from this passage is that even if you're a Bible scholar, your life will not be changed unless you encounter the resurrected Jesus. There is people all over the world that know the scripture, that know what the Bible says about who God is or who Jesus is. They know what the Bible says about how they should live, and yet they've never encountered the resurrected Jesus. And so, therefore, they're really no different. They're still without God. In fact, many people do more damage in the name of God because they've never encountered the resurrected Jesus. They know the scripture and they use the scripture to bring judgment, when Jesus came to bring forgiveness and righteousness and love. It's a very different thing. And Saul knew the scripture. He was brilliant, trained under the best teachers of the law. And yet he didn't have the resurrection power inside of him. Saul, he knew who God was and wasn't. For example, the way he understood the scripture, he knew that God could never come as a human. This completely offended him. He missed or didn't understand the scriptures that talk about Jesus coming. He didn't get it. And so he was so certain that he knew who God was that certainly Jesus wasn't. He also knew, as an example, you know, Stephen, as he was about to be martyred, he's talking about how the sacrificial system was going to be abolished. You know, before Jesus, the Jews would sacrifice animals, and that was their way of asking for forgiveness from God. And so Stephen's saying, yeah, that sacrificial system, that's going away. We don't need the sacrificial system anymore. Jesus came once and for all, the Lamb of God. He was sacrificed on the cross. He paid the price. We don't need to sacrifice animals. He did it for us. He can forgive our sins. And so Saul knew, oh, this can't be God. He would never abolish the sacrificial system. He gave us the sacrificial system. And so Saul became indignant. He became angry. And he was persecuting Christians. The second thing I want you to see is that so often people choose to see God as they want to see him rather than as he really is. This is really profound. You know, how you view God affects your whole worldview, affects your future, affects your destiny. many people view God as a distant God. I'm one person out of 6 billion people on the planet. God is way up there, and we're all just like little ants. Does he even know which one I am? You know, how could a God so far away know me? And so we live a life as if he's distant. Some people view God as an angry God. If God knew what a screw-up I was, if God knew how bad I messed up, if God only knew what my past was, he would never love me. There's no way. There's no way he could. And so we see God as an angry God, a judging God, a punishing God. My life, I'm just living a life of punishment for what I've done. God isn't love. God is angry. And so we create this whole worldview centered around God being an angry God. In my own life, I've shared with you the last few weeks some of my struggles. You know, one of the things that I've dealt with my whole life is I've struggled with perfectionism. I always want to be perfect. I always want to do things right. I want to do it right the first time. Even when I've never tried something like a rap, I expect myself to do it perfect. I think I had some childhood wounding from the rap, actually. But because I had this perfectionism, this lie that I had to be perfect, I attributed that to God. And so every time I would mess up, every time I would fall short, I would think, surely God must be disappointed with me. I've let him down. God demands my perfection, and I'm nowhere near. How could I deserve God's love? And God's been working in my heart, and now he's showing me, Jason, I never demanded your perfection. All I wanted was your heart. All I wanted was your love. I just wanted to be your friend. I wanted to heal you from those places in your heart and set you free. But so often, we choose to see God as we want rather than as he is. And we create our own God who is nothing like the God that's described in the Bible. I put this quote in your notes. This is from Tim Keller, who's a theologian and teacher, and I just really respect him. And he said, "The God you create can never change you because you created him. He's a product of your heart. The deepest need you have is for a God that is not the product of your deepest needs." This is a very significant thought. You know, if you're struggling with feeling worthless, how are you ever going to overcome the feeling of worthlessness? Well, the way we usually do it is we'll either try to block it out, right? We'll fill our lives with activity and work and entertainment and friends and socializing and whatever it is. And we just try to ignore this gnawing feeling of worthlessness. Or we'll make bad decisions. We'll get into bad relationships and we'll look to people to try to fill this pain that's inside of us, that I'm no good, that I'm not worthy. What's really going to change that feeling of worthlessness? It's not going to be anything you do or anything you create. It's going to be letting a God in who can take the worthlessness out of you and give you worthiness. Only God can do that. Only God. Are you tired of the life you're living? Are you tired of the same old struggles? Are you tired of feeling burdened by the bad choices you've made? Are you tired of living in fear or anxiety? Are you tired of wondering, will God ever provide for my needs? Are you tired of wondering, can God really heal me? Are you tired of struggling with whatever it is you're struggling with? The only way that you can actually have real life change is to invite someone in who's not the product of your own heart. And that is Jesus. It's the only way is to invite the resurrection power of Jesus to come in your life and to change you. You see, we all need a God who can come into our life and tell us things that maybe we don't want to hear. He can tell us things that maybe confuse us or scare us because we don't understand. We all need a God that can do that. Why? Because then he can change us, and then he can tell us all the good things that are too good to be true, that we could never imagine. It's just like if you're married or if you have a good friend or a boyfriend or girlfriend or whatever. What makes a good relationship? What makes a real relationship? One of the things that makes a real relationship is the opportunity to share with each other honest feedback about your relationship, right? You know, so my wife and I, she'll tell me, hey, you're really talking harshly to the kids today. Can we talk about this? Or you've brought a bad attitude home from work. You know, what's going on? It's affecting our whole house. Or, you know, I felt like you were critical just now. You used a harsh word against me. You know, those are uncomfortable conversations. You know, we don't like hearing those things, but we have those conversations because we love each other, right? We have a destiny that's higher and a calling that's more advanced than just struggling with these things, and so we have hard conversations. And it's the same thing with God. You need a God that can come into your life and give you feedback about your life. That's the only way that you'll actually be changed. That's the only way that you'll know the way forward to get unstuck from where you've been, maybe for your whole life. My wife Sarah was telling me, you know, she was reminding me, she grew up loving God. She grew up in church. She grew up going on mission trips. And as a young adult, she walked away from the Lord. She had many hardships in her life. She had trauma, and she got into an abusive relationship, and she walked away from God. But she knew God. She believed in God, and yet she had God like this. He was at arm's length. And so periodically she would cry out to God, God, I'm really sad, or God, help me, I'm hurting. But she would always be like this, help me, but you can only get this close. I don't want you to tell me what choices I'm making that are harming my life. You don't have permission to come in that close. And so God could never really work a miracle in her life. And it wasn't until one day she walked into church here and she said, God, I don't want to be like this. I want to be like this. I invite you, Jesus. I invite you in to the deepest places of my heart. I give you permission to speak into my life, to change me, to heal me, to set me free. And it was that day that God began to do miracles in her life. It was that day that she began to see, I'm not a victim. I don't deserve to be abused. I'm an heir to the King of Kings. I'm royalty. I'm loved. I'm adopted. She began to be set free from hurts that she'd had for her whole life. And it was all grace. It was all God giving it to her. It wasn't anything she did. But it wasn't until she opened her arms and said, come in, Jesus, could he do the miracle? And some of you today, you've had God like this in your life. And Jesus so wants you to invite him like this. He wants to change you. He wants to heal you. The Bible says there's freedom. There's freedom in Christ. Some of you don't even know what that word means. It's some thought that doesn't mean anything. Freedom. You can actually be free from anxiety. You can actually be free from sin. You can actually be free from feeling the devastation of the choices you've made. You can be free today because Jesus conquered sin and death. Amen. And it's the moment you give your life to Jesus, you are no longer on plan B, on plan C. You are on plan A. God puts you back on the track that he designed for you. He's not punishing you. He's using everything in your life for his good. He will use everything for His glory to take you to exactly the destination He wants you to go. And last, the resurrection is personal. It's personal. Can you show that verse 4 again? This is the big bombshell in this story. This is the punch to the gut. Saul fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Persecuting me. Jesus, why does he say that? Jesus was resurrected. He was in heaven. Why doesn't Jesus say, "Why are you persecuting them? Why are you persecuting the Christians?" He says, "Why are you persecuting me?" In the next verse, he tells him, "It's me you're persecuting." He reinforces it. The amazing thing about being a Christian means that you're united with Christ. When you invite Jesus into your life, when God looks at you, He sees you as one with Him. When Jesus is living in you, when God looks at you, He sees Jesus. In Galatians, the Bible says that I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. When we give our life to God, our old self is gone, it's dead, and we have new life. And when God looks at us, He sees Jesus. We are united. Everything that we feel that we're struggling with, Jesus sees, He knows, He experiences it. Jesus in heaven was experiencing persecution, the persecution of the saints. And some of you today, you're saying, "Jason, what you're saying is, it all sounds really great. And yeah, I believe in Jesus that He died and rose. But do you know what I'm going through? Do you know how far my kids have fallen away? Do you know how bad my marriage is? Do you know how devastated I am by the loss of my loved one? Where's God? Why is this happening to me? Where is this Jesus, this resurrected Jesus? Does He really care about me?" The answer is yes, He does. In heaven, He was experiencing persecution. Christianity, Jesus, this is the only religion, if you want to call it religion, that can make any claim to understanding suffering and injustice. No other religion can make the claim that Christianity can. You see, because Jesus, when He was on the cross, when He laid down His life for you willingly and freely, He suffered the ultimate torment. He had the weight of all of our sins upon Him. He was paying the penalty for our sin. We could never pay for it. Even if we died, we could never, our blood, our sin was too, the price was too high that we could never afford. We could never pay the price to be united with the Lord. And Jesus was paying that price. And Jesus on the cross experienced something that He never had experienced before, forever. Jesus, the Holy Spirit, they've been alive forever. And Jesus experienced something on that cross that He had never experienced. And that was a disconnection from His Father. His Father looked away from Him. He never knew what it was like to be separated from His Father. And Jesus on the cross said, "Why? God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus understands your suffering. He understands your pain. He cares like no other, I promise you. For on that cross, He asked the same question you ask. Why? And why you're going through things, I don't know the answer. And the timing of you being free from those things, I don't know the answer. But I know this. You can trust His heart for you. He is a good God. He cares for you. He cares for every circumstance and everything that is happening in your life. He sees you. The beauty of the resurrection is that we can receive new life. All of us at one time or another have been afraid to die. One of the great benefits of resurrection, the resurrection power, is that when we receive Jesus, we are guaranteed that we will live forever in heaven, in perfect fellowship, where there is no pain and no suffering, no sadness, no sorrow. And not only that, in heaven, every sad story becomes untrue. There is such a redemption that happens in heaven, we don't fully understand it, but literally, in heaven, you will be filled with so much joy that even the bad things that happen, you will actually give thanks to God, because He will replace it with so much joy that you will be blown away. You remember when I said you need a God who can tell you hard things so that He can tell you the things that are too good to be true? This is one of those things. It sounds too good to be true, but it is true. When you give your life to Jesus, you can live for eternity with Him. When you give your life to Jesus, your sins can be forgiven. When you give your life to Jesus, you can be adopted into a family. Maybe you don't have a family. Today, you can be adopted into the family of God. It sounds too good to be true, but it is true. And you know what? It has nothing to do with you and everything to do with Jesus. What I love about the story of Saul was he was a murderer. He was a rager. He was full of anger and hate. And Jesus met him. And Jesus changed him. And the scales came off of his eyes and he could see. But when he saw, it was completely different. And today God wants to come and remove scales from eyes. Some of you maybe have never seen Jesus. Maybe not, and maybe you won't see him physically today, but you will see him in a way you've never seen him. He wants to give you new eyes today. And it's all about Him. Salvation is a free gift. You can do nothing today to make God love you more than He does right now. And you can do nothing to make God love you less than He does right now. This is the good news of the gospel. You can be forgiven, and it's all a gift. It's all free. It's all paid for. All you have to do is say yes. Others of you, you know the Lord, but there's dead places in your heart. There's dreams that have been dormant. God gave you a dream a long time ago. And whatever happened, that dream has been lost. The Holy Spirit is here today, and He wants to bring resurrection life into dead dreams. Some of you have dead marriages or dead relationships. Wherever there is deadness in your life, the Holy Spirit wants to breathe life today. And as I said at the beginning, God has miracles for us, but He needs to increase our faith for the miracles He wants to do. Maybe you've been a Christian and you've had victory, but now God's calling you to the next level. He's calling you to go up in your faith. He's calling you to take a step and believe for a miracle that you've never believed for, that you've never thought was possible. And God's bringing to your mind right now a miracle, something He wants to breathe His life into today. We're going to close right now, and I'm going to invite the worship team. And if you would stand with me, I'm going to close in prayer. And if you would just bow your heads with me as we pray. And I just want to ask today, some of you, you are tired. You're tired of trying to solve all your problems with your own solutions. Some of you today want to invite Jesus to be the Lord of your life, just like my wife, who had Jesus at an arm's length. You want to open your hands and say, Jesus, come in. Jesus, I give you the title deed. Jesus, I give you control of my life. Jesus, I ask that you would save me. I ask that you would give me eternal life forever. And if that's you, if you say, yes, I need Jesus, would you just raise your hand? I just want to lead you in a prayer. I see your hands. I see your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Would you just pray with me? And everyone can say this prayer after me. Dear Jesus, I thank you that you died on the cross and rose from the dead. And Jesus, I'm so sorry for my sin and for breaking your heart. Would you please forgive me, Lord? I invite you into my heart. I give you my life. I give you permission to change me and to free me and to heal me. In Jesus' name. And others of you, I just want to pray for you. If the Holy Spirit was speaking to you when I was sharing that God wants to breathe life into dead places, I just want to pray for you. If that was you, you could just hold your hands out. And I just want to pray, Lord, I just pray right now in the name of Jesus that your resurrection power would be released in this room, that all dead places would be brought back to life, dead dreams, dead relationships, broken bodies, wherever there is death, you would breathe life in Jesus' name, that you would speak destiny and hope and a future in these things that have been lost. In Jesus' name, receive it.